Learning gives creativity.
Creativity leads to thinking.
Thinking provides knowledge.
And knowledge makes you great. Ladies and gentlemen, we have amongst us Mr. Roy Joseph, Vice President HR, MRF Limited. Sir, welcome to our corporate interface.
May I request Professor Biju G. Pillai to felicitate our guest with a bouquet of flowers.
I call upon student manager Soumya Celis to introduce our guest.
Good afternoon, one and all. I, Soumya Celis, student manager, BIMM, takes an immense pleasure to introduce Mr. Roy Joseph, VPHR of MRF Limited. Mr. Roy Joseph is an alumnus from St. Xavier's College, Calcutta, and XLRI Jamshedpur, with a specialization in IR and HR. With over 29 years of diverse work experience, he commenced his career in the industrial relations area and spent his formative years with Bata India Limited. Thereafter joined HLL with ice cream business right from its project stage. He went on to work with British American Tobacco in London and then seconded to India as head of HR of its associate companies. He also was head of HR function of Diageo India and looked after L&D function across the venture markets in Europe and Asia. Currently, he is heading human resources for MRF Limited India, based out of Chennai. He has certified in change management from Change First in US and did his OD certification from NTL in US. It's a privilege to have you amongst us, sir. Now, I request Mr. Roy Joseph to share your words of wisdom. Sir, the podium is all yours.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
I'm actually overwhelmed. I'm coming to this institute after very many years. I know some of your professors like Professor Biju and others whom I've met many, many years ago. And they've been kind enough to look me up every now and then when they come to whichever part of the country that I'm in. And of course, I remember Bala sir extremely well. Who would not? And I was just telling Soumya and others that the energy that he displays, even today, would put a lot of youngsters to shame. Let me start with a small story. I won't put you off to sleep with the story, it's a very small story. Please hear me out. Very far away, in a small village, there were two trees. One tree was next to the riverbank, full of leaves and fruits, and its leaves were also touching, the branches were also touching the river. At a distance, you had another tree, just fairly dry, gnarled, didn't have too many leaves, not too many fruits either. So the villagers there would celebrate all their occasions around this tree which was next to the riverbed, full of greenery, their marriages, rituals, customs, the pujas, everything was conducted there. No one ever went to this old tree. They hated it. And they were hoping that one day it would die so they could chop the tree and use the wood for celebration under this tree. Then one day, a severe storm came in. And so the villagers were all celebrating. Ah, now this old tree will be gone and we can celebrate. The next morning when they woke up to their dismay, they found that the tree next to the riverbank had gone. But this other tree, which was far away, still stood firm like a rock, because its roots were deep, its roots were nourished, it had a lot of strength, and it could withstand anything that nature threw at it. I firmly believe that Balaji Institute is one such institute with firm conviction, beliefs, dedication, everything which has made this institute come from its humble beginnings to what it is today. And you people are the ones who are actually going to make it even more stronger. So a big hand to all of you people. The topic that I was given, basically on globalization, emerging, how does it emerge? Frankly, it's too large a topic to cover in one day, if you ask me, because no one can ever say what's going to happen in the next few years. The sort of changes that we have seen in the last 3-4 years is 10 times the changes that we've seen in the last 30 years. But globalization is here to stay. Companies are expanding their businesses. So what happens? What's the result or impact of this? Unfamiliar languages, laws, style, culture. Every function needs to be at a global standard. Employees need to be adaptable. It also puts a premium on certain skills. And management of careers becomes even more difficult. See, gone are the days when I remember, most of you must have been probably 1 or 2 years at that point in time, but the professors here will definitely remember. Way back in 1998, there was a Southeast Asian crisis. We had the huge problem with regard to even devaluation there. But India was insular. Nothing happened to India. Nothing happened. We said, no, we are a very resilient economy. We don't depend on the outside. We are too strong an economy. Come to 9/11, when 9/11 happened, it hit the world. We were still insular to an extent. 2008, when the Lehman crisis blew up, it had a trickle of its impact in India. Today, in the current crisis that you're seeing, when the petrol prices have really dropped, you have Brexit, all these things have an impact on the companies that are originating from the Indian shores and are operating globally. Today, you cannot operate only within your own country and become a leading player. The world has become too small for that. If you think you're going to be a king operating only within your country, then we are living in a fool's paradise, because the borders are open. Anyone can come in and set up shop. And also, when you start operating in different cultures, the one big challenge that most of us will face, the cultures of people are going to be different. And unless you know how to handle multicultures, you will not succeed as an organization. It also has an impact, job losses. Computers, robotics, and automation are drivers of production. We feel, yes, we become more productive. But what happens when you have increasing robotics and automation? It actually calls for the more repetitive jobs, the more manual jobs, to be replaced by machines and automation. And this is now being felt even in the IT industry, where about 10% of the lower jobs are actually going to go out. If you look at MRF today, we have 9 factories in the country. The first factory was set up way back. We've set up 3 of these 9, 3 are very modern factories, and they are as good as any in the world that you can come across. They have robotics and automation and everything. And the sort of people that we employ in these new factories is a fraction of what we employ in the old factories. We are already seeing it firsthand. Where else do you think robotics plays its part? If you look at even the e-commerce industry, Amazon. I was chatting with Soumya and Baiju in the car. We're talking about, what is Amazon doing today? Drones. And it's a matter of time before, how many of you order Domino's pizza? Okay. All of us do. It's a matter of time that many of these things are delivered at your doorstep with the help of drones. It's just a matter of time. 10 years back, you could never even imagine this. But this is how technology is changing and shaping the lives of each one of us. You don't know what could actually happen, because in the digital era, the sort of changes that will come upon us, it'll be too fast for us to even comprehend. And I'll come to that a little while from now. This has an impact on the number and type of jobs. We can say that, oh my God, robotics and automation is very bad. You know, what's going to happen? Yes, what's going to happen? Yes, there'll be some jobs which will go out. It'll then put a lot of pressure on us to ensure that we actually scale up. And whenever there is a pressure on us, we actually do scale up. Oxford Martin School in 2013 study had mentioned that there'll be 47% of jobs in the United States are at risk of being automated using artificial intelligence. It is already happening. Need to create jobs for future. Basically, the idea here is to remain contemporary. The future does not mean 10 years from today and 15 years from today, 20 years from today. The future can be even 2 years from today. 2 years from today, the future is going to be very, very different from what it is today. That's the sort of speed of change in which we are operating. On-demand economy. Stable, permanent, full-time jobs are going to be replaced by an anywhere, anytime work model facilitated by digital technology. With this Uber and Ola coming in a big way. You have a lot of people, a lot of executives who have their own cars, and it's actually catching up in a lot of metro cities. They use their own cars in the evening saying that, look, I don't mind being a driver for that particular point in time. I will use my car because that is an extra piece of income for me. And it's not that he will do it every day. He will not. He will do it when it's convenient for him. And these sort of jobs are going to increase as we go into the future. So full-time jobs, yes, there will be full-time jobs. I'm not heralding saying that full-time jobs are going to go out, but there will be a lot more of this short-term jobs, contractual jobs coming in. Shift towards more of contractual work. Even the Indian government is seized of this. They are trying desperately to change the laws. It's taking time. India, everything does take some time. What they're planning to do, because I'm on one of the subcommittees, what they're planning to do is ensure that you can hire and fire, yes, but your contractual job, what you pay your contractual workmen, is going to be more or less equivalent to your permanent workmen. That will definitely increase the cost of manufacture, definitely, but it also ensures that people, the contractual workmen, are coming into the mainstream. It will also ensure that when times are tough, when business cycles happen, and when there's a trough, you are able to get rid of a lot of people. So it shows up your fortunes. More rootless and flexible workforce. On-demand economy is starting to revolutionize commercial behavior, Uber, Handy, Airbnb. Industries historically slow to innovate are seeing hypergrowth in the on-demand world. Transportation, grocery, restaurant, and personal service industries. What's the impact and what are the results? On-demand economy gives consumers more choice. It's definitely good for consumers. Winners, consumers who want choice and workers who value flexibility over security, such as younger workers with portable skills or those who don't want to work full-time. There will be many of you as you go further on. I've seen many of my batchmates about 5-10 years back, they stopped working on a permanent basis. Now you can argue saying that, oh, they must have made a lot of money, so they want to retire. Not necessarily so. Many of them started valuing other things. When you talk about work-life balance, they say, look, I really don't want to be in the rat race. What I want is that I want a certain income, which I can make through not being on permanent employment, and I have time to do a lot of other things. Threatened, those who value security over flexibility. They will definitely be threatened. Have families or have mortgages are all threatened. The more encumbrances you have, the more you're going to get tied down. And you have lots of WhatsApp jokes saying that, okay, if you don't love your job, take a housing loan, you know, all those. But if you look at it, it's very, very true. The moment you have a housing loan, okay, you will tend to take a lot of things in your stride. Why? Because you have a liability. The moment your children are growing up and you need to send them to college and other places, you'll tend to keep quiet. Why? Because you have a liability. It also ensures then that your own creativity and your own flexibility, etc., is actually getting curtailed and stymied. Competition challenge. Fighting for the customer's wallet pie. Starting a business is very easy compared to earlier. Buy a domain, register your business. You look at almost everyone today is looking at startups. Every big institute is looking at startups and how to seed it. There are venture funds. A lot of big capitalists, a lot of big philanthropists are creating funds enough to help people do startups. I don't know how many of you would think of going in for a startup after a couple of years of working or even immediately after passing out. Staying in business is complicated. You have experts online. Firms are there for marketing, manufacturing your product, all at reasonable cost. And here I want to reflect on a research done by McKinsey. And they did this research over decades. And they analyzed companies worldwide over several decades. And they found that if a particular company is the number one in a particular decade, the chances of it retaining the number one slot or being the leader slot in the next decade comes down to only 6%. 94% fail to hold on. And what's more, even more interesting is that post that, if they want to get back into the leadership, the probability of success has been 0.7%. So what it says is that to reach somewhere is very quick. With a lot of effort, you can, because you've thought differently from the pack. But what happens to all of us is that once we reach the summit, we think we have arrived. And when we think we've arrived, that's a sure death knell for us. Because others are also reinventing. Others are playing catch up and wanting to go one step ahead. To remain there becomes even more difficult. And that is proven by research across the globe. And if you look at companies in India or even, how many of you have read this book, Built to Last by Collins and Jeremy Porras? Anyone? Okay, if you haven't, my humble request to you is that please read it. It's not a contemporary book in the sense that it's not been published recently. It's been published in the early 90s. It talks about visionary companies and how they've lasted over time. Of course, there are sequels to that, Good to Great and others. Read that book, Built to Last. It tells you about how visionary companies have gone about building their companies to be very, very successful. Ease of business creates a broader level of competition. Customers are changing suppliers with the click of a mouse. Today, you are no longer tied to a particular supplier. Even for yourself. How many of you buy branded clothes here? Okay, all of us. How many of you prefer Wranglers to Levi's? And how many of you prefer Levi's to Wranglers? Suppose those of you who prefer Wrangler, suppose Levi's is giving a 50% discount and Wranglers is not. How many of you will want to buy a Levi's then? I would. Because as far as I'm concerned, okay, that label is different, but the jeans are still the same. Each one of us can today change our suppliers very easily. And so it is true for even organizations. Because everyone today, quality is a given. The times of the 60s and 70s are over when you talk about quality as a differentiating factor. Today, if you do not give quality, you will not survive. You're finished. So when quality is a given, you are going to ensure that you are going to stick to a supplier who is going to remain contemporary with you and grow with you. Competition challenge, how do you handle it? Identify and know your customer. Reach your message out to him effectively. And when you talk about identifying and knowing your customer, this is where digital plays a big role. And increasingly, that's going to happen. In every sphere, even in the sphere of tires, even in the sphere of cars, the sort of research they're doing on you is next to impossible. So much so that your behavioral patterns with regard to what you buy, which months you buy, et cetera, is very well known. Go where the customer is going, in short, continuous adaptation. Workplace integrity. Now all this also, slowly, it doesn't mean that you can cut corners. Today, I think, I don't know if any of you are aware, in the early 2000s, there was a company called Enron. How many of you remember this company? Sorry? Enron. Does it exist today? What happened? Window dressing. And you know what was the values of Enron? It was enshrined as rice. Respect, integrity. I think C stood for credibility and E stood for excellence. You can have all these nice values embellished on your wall, but if you do not practice it, you're finished. No matter how big you are. Struggle to be more successful, make the next quarterly earnings update numbers. Now, this is important, not so much in India yet, but if you look at the Wall Street and if you look at London Stock Exchange, the CEOs there live quarter by quarter. If they do not give the returns, the board can ask them to change, ask them to move out. So they live by quarter. They have to perform every quarter. Earn the next year's bonus, very important for them, because that's what really matters, and to compete effectively. Many business owners, employees, what they succumb to, temptations to cut corners, omit information, to do whatever it takes. These practices erode trust between employers and employees, between business partners, between executives and shareholders. Lack of trust leads to inability to compete effectively. And this is going to play a pivotal role as we go forward. If you look at even in the country today, even in India, the sort of stipulations that SEBI is coming up with, even in your balance sheet, even in the annual report, how many of you read annual reports of companies? Okay. I would recommend that you start analyzing this a lot more deeply. When you look at annual reports of companies, today SEBI also stipulates that you must give what the highest paid executive in your company is paid. If it's an owner shareholder, so be it. And give that as a ratio of what the lowest person is being paid and the average person is being paid. It is calling for more and more of transparency. You cannot keep on hiding facts and figures. It's impossible now. The government is getting at this very, very deeply. Your Aadhaar card is going to be something on which everything is going to revolve around. Ethical dilemmas, breaking privacy of employees, downsizing, whistleblowing, employee remuneration, managing ethics, code of ethics by top management, ethics committee, ethics hotline, ethics training programs, taking legal recourse. Now, these things are still in its infancy in India. But if you look at any MNC today, they have, all of them have a code of conduct, which they live by very, very clearly. And if anyone violates the code of conduct, it's the end of that person in that organization. India is just catching up. Slowly, organizations are bringing out their code of conduct. Basically, it tells that this is what is acceptable practice for any employee in a company, and this is unacceptable practice. Redefining work. Organizations will use small number of highly skilled people in order to enhance their competitiveness. This is increasingly happening. If you look at any industry, today, you have a dearth of engineers equipped in the automation area. You have a dearth of engineers and people who are equipped with regard to robotics. Now, these are the areas that are really going to start becoming the big thing for tomorrow. These are the skills that are going to be in demand tomorrow. Use of digital business models and automation and computerization of jobs. See, everyone is talking about IoT. I don't need to talk about what IoT is. All of you know about it. Big data. Everyone's talking about big data. I have a classmate of mine from school. He finished off from Berkeley in the US. When he came the other day, I asked him, he came home to Chennai, his parents are there. So what are you working on? He says, look, I'm working on the future of computing. And he tried to explain to me, frankly, I didn't understand one thing. Because he says, what he was trying to explain to me was something really, really, I have not understood at all. And I was just imagining to myself, my God, if this is what is going to happen in the next 5 to 10 years, the sort of catching up that we want to do is tremendous. Cheap computing power is transforming the way consumers and workers access technology. Risk and change management will be crucial to ensuring success. implications to how we manage work and also on quality of life. We talk about quality of life and we say that work-life balance, etc. As you start working is very important. And yet, this is something that is not paid too much of heed. But increasingly, executives are realizing that unless they give equal importance to work-life balance, they will not be productive on the shop floor. New age working is defined by irregular patterns of work. You've seen this in the BPO, you've seen this in the IT industry. And it's just not a question of BPO or IT industry. Today, your customer can be in any part of the globe. And he wants, when he wants a solution, he wants it immediately. He's not going to wait. Because if you make him wait, some other engineer or some other executive from some other part of the globe will fulfill that demand. Makes boundaries between work and non-work indistinguishable, brings more work into personal time, speeds up the way organizations function and respond to customers, defining when a person is working and when they are not will be an increasing challenge. More and more people are allowed to work from home. So if you say I'm allowed to work from home, what is the time that I have for myself and what is the time that I'm working? How can you really differentiate that? It's not that every industry has got into it. Manufacturing industry will find it very, very difficult because the manufacturing is happening in the shop floor and not in your homes. But new age industries give this option. Now we come to education and training. So what does that mean for education and training? The education system itself will need to be able to predict what sort of change you require, what sort of knowledge you require for this particular person who's come out from an engineering institute to start working. You need to ensure that your students are going to be a lot more adaptable and willing to learn and willing to unlearn whatever they learned in the institute. Workforce not adaptable enough to changes in technology. Organizations not providing proper lifelong education solutions for retraining to move into new roles. Increasingly, companies are coming up with their own academies. Why are they coming up with their own academies? They need to ensure, they want to ensure that their students remain contemporary all their life. Because that's the only way they're going to be productive for the organization. Because the institute, whether it's an engineering institute or an MBA institute, will train them up to be contemporary for that period of time. Whatever you learned is good enough for a few years. And then the change starts happening so quickly that unless you adapt, you're going to be left way behind. Thank you. New model of requirement, well-rounded professional development, and which boosts workers' capacity to learn and think in a world where creative and critical skills are at a premium. We are seeing this in our own workplace, where we have the old factories and the new factories. The new factories, we are talking about the latest technology in the world. And we know that unless we involve the workmen, unless they come up with solutions and they come up with kaizens, that's improvements, we're not going to survive. So the sort of work, that sort of training that we are deploying for these new workmen is a lot different from the older factories. Diversity. Many have talked about diversity, and in fact, about 20 years back, when you talk about diversity, the only diversity that I understood was that, okay, how many ladies and how many gents do you have working in the company? Diversity goes far, far beyond all that. It goes into skills, it goes into culture, it goes into abilities, it goes into almost everything. And one may ask, you know, why do you require all this? It is proven again by research that the more diverse an organization, the more successful and productive it is. Of course, there are prejudices to it. There are minuses to it, like prejudices, stereotypes, discrimination, harassment, sexual harassment, backlash. India is also changing in that regard. If you look at the laws, enactment, of course, we take two steps forward and then we take a step backward. But it is happening. Those changes are also happening in the country. Managing diversity. So some of the ways to manage diversity is increasing awareness, increasing diversity of skills, cultural diversity, gender diversity, committing top management to diversity. Technology transformation, automation and IT. Leaner organizations, wired organizations, virtual offices, changing nature of management work. I think you've heard of this enough. When you talk about, you know, IoT and other things, there's enough and more being talked about, and every day something new is coming up. Planning. How many of you do planning for the next year or the next day? How many of you? Okay. I'm great. Great. I'm very happy that many of you have put your hands up on planning. Let's see what we have to say. No plan survives contact with the future unless the future drives the plan. No plan survives contact with the future unless the future drives the plan. If you're going to plan for the future based on what you know today and what you think is existing today and what you think is going to be relevant today, it may actually not benefit you. And this is where envisioning the future is very, very important. Because unless you envision the future, that's the only thing which will drive your planning. I was hoping this would be a bigger slide, but okay, forgive me for it. The future approaches and methods. I need to read it out from there. Your strategic thinking, generating options, what might happen. That gives you the options. And your options, in turn, helps you make your strategic decisions. Making choices, what will you do? So that gives you the decisions. Your decisions help you in your strategic planning, taking action. How will we do it? The actions. Conventional business thinking, near-term and detail-oriented. Futures thinking, breadth and depth of vision. Own business focus vis-a-vis cross-disciplinary. See, gone are the times when you would look at only one particular vertical. Today, what's more important is going to be cross-functional, cross-functional teams. And when you talk about cross-functional teams, you don't have hierarchical control. So therefore, one of the competencies that's going to matter a lot is going to be on influencing. How do you influence people who are not reporting into you? How do you influence people whom you don't even see face-to-face? You're speaking at the end of a phone. Or at the maximum, on telepresence or on a video conference. How do you influence such people when you don't even know them face-to-face? You've never met them face-to-face, except on video conferencing or perhaps on a telephone call. Linear future thinking, focus non-linear thinking with trends and emerging issues with assessment of wild cards and discontinuities. I'll come to wild cards a little bit later. Problem approach to systems approach. Bottom line focus to strategic focus. Undiscussables to speak the unspeakable. Short-term focus versus long-term orientation. Past and present dominate decision-making. Future dominates decision-making. Oops. The future ahead. Strategic thinking is identifying, thinking about, and understanding possible and plausible future operating environments for your organization. So you can use that knowledge to expand your thinking about your potential options, to position your organization effectively in the external environment in order to make better informed decisions about action to take today. This is one of my favorite quotes. We can't solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created them. It's a truism, but you know, oftentimes we forget this. We start here. Long-term, uncertain, divergent, incomplete, beyond linear, disrupting alignment. All of you have read enough and more about the VUCA world, right? That's what you have inherited. But we end up here, short-term, logical, convergent, pragmatic, deductive, creating alignment. So what do? Scan the environment, systematically exploring and interpreting the external environment to better understand the nature of trends and drivers of change, and their likely future impact on your organization. It's important because this is what envisioning is all about. You can be very successful in what you're doing today, but unless you envisage that what's going to happen and envision what's going to happen in the future, you can be laid back very badly. There was a very successful company in India. All of you know the company, Nokia. Yes? Where is it today? Sorry? No idea. What happened to Nokia? It stopped innovating. It stopped envisioning the future. Why? Because the mobile sets that they made, they were so successful with it that they stopped envisioning what the future would be. And the smartphone came and left them far behind. This is true for almost many industries, many companies. Who invented the quartz watches? Which country was the quartz watches invented? Sorry? Switzerland. In fact, most people would say it's Japan. But actually, it was Switzerland. But they were so successful with their mechanical and hand-wound watches that they refused to accept it. What do the Japanese do? They're very good at capturing it and miniaturizing it, and they mass-produced it. Mercifully, the Swiss understood they were going to get laid behind. They quickly jumped onto the bandwagon. And that saved that watch industry in Switzerland. I'm sorry, this is an important slide, but it's going to be too small for you to read at the back. I'll try and see, you know. On the axis here, the right at the bottom is short term, the time horizon, and of course the long term. And on the horizontal axis, the narrow to the broad. It goes from competitive intelligence to competitive intelligence to business intelligence to environmental scanning, social intelligence, and future view. I will leave these slides with you so you can have a look at it. This is not my slide. This is, I've adapted from Chu Information Management for Intelligent Organizations, which just came out in 1998, and it still holds true for any organization which wants to do scenario planning. Okay, a little busy slide, but this is the external environment. You have globalization, you have global, you have technology, you've got lifestyle, you've got values, you've got politics, you've got economy, you've got environment, demographics and generational change, learning, sustainability, engagement, industry, and of course, right in the core, in the middle, is the organization. And you have these wild cards. What are these wild cards? Any idea? A 9/11 is a wild card. A Lehman Brothers happening is a wild card. A Brexit threatens to be a wild card. Because these things, no matter what happens, despite the best of plans that you have, totally disrupt everything that you have in mind. Totally disrupt every single strategic plan, every single business plan. If you are going hunky-dory, suddenly you'll find everything going awry. As I was coming in from the airport to your institute, a friend of mine from Dubai rang up. So she was mentioning that I was asking her, how is the environment there in Dubai? She's saying it's same as 2008. Because when the Lehman Brothers hit, Dubai was very badly hit in 2008. She's saying same thing's happening now. People are being laid off. So anyone who has a job in Dubai or in the Middle East is considered lucky. In India, we haven't faced that yet. We haven't faced that yet. But it's happening around us. When you start scanning, you'll find lots of events. When you start scanning the environment for looking at, and this is all those of you in marketing, when you look at annual brand plan, how do you go about doing it, you look at a lot of events. And then look at trends. And gradually, you'll be able to group similar hits into broader categories. That's the trends. Trends and emerging issues. Right from innovators to early adopters, late adopters, laggards. Now, who are the innovators? The scientists, artists, radicals, mystics, the mavericks, as you can call them. So would you call Bill Gates a maverick? He didn't want to attend college. He hardly had anything. But he thought out of the box. Basically, anyone who starts thinking outside the box are the ones who are going to be innovators. Most scanning takes place here. That's the early adopters and the late majority. Because so far we've been the innovators. But we need to look on the fringe as well. That's the scientists, artists, radicals, mystics, those who do the early innovation. Because that's where the trends will actually start emanating. In the past, the scientists and others, by the time they came up with something, it took about 5 to 10 years for it to get accepted. Today, it's going to be much, much more rapid. If you don't scan that part very clearly and early, you'll find yourself swamped suddenly. How many of you could think that e-commerce would become such a big industry? Delivering things at your doorstep at a huge discount to what you would go and buy in a supermarket or in a mall. If you look at uncertainty and the time and the future, usual planning time frame is 3 to 5 years. Every company talks about a 3-year horizon, 5-year horizon. The Indian government had a 5-year plan. How many of you remember this 5-year plan? Anyone? I'm sure the professors will remember it. All the famous 5-year plans. What's happened to all of them? It's become irrelevant today. Similarly, in industry, in companies, when you talk about a 5-year plan, this is where I want to be in 5 years and 10 years, etc. Oftentimes, companies have been forced to revisit what it thought was good enough in 5 years from today. Sometimes they don't even exist 5 years from today. There are a lot of possible futures, and that's what the scanning and the envisioning needs to do. You may look at it from a linear future, it doesn't happen that way. There could be lots of possible futures. And unless you are ready to analyze that and envision that, you will not be able to see the trend in the industry. And of course, don't forget the wild card. Because despite all your robust planning, everything that you do, one wild card. For example, India is going at 7.9% or 8% or whatever the GDP growth that everyone seems to be projecting. What do you think could be a wild card for India? Anyone? No rains is not necessarily going to be a wild card. It will be a short blip. A wild card would be a nuclear war with Pakistan. They could be trigger happy. They also have nuclear capability. Imagine that happens. It could be a real wild card for us. If you are looking for new ideas that don't yet exist, don't talk to normal people because they're just consuming what is available today. Find the weirdos and see what they are doing, what they are making on their own, and say, is there something I can mainstream from this? This is where industry is looking at. When you talk about consumer insight, and those of you in marketing will of course talk about, will be doing this a lot more, consumer insight. Any idea what is consumer insight? Yes, no? Okay. When I was working at Diageo, and I was looking after learning and development across Asia, Pacific, and Europe, and whatever. One of their core capabilities that they identified was consumer insight. Basically, consumer insight is basically talking, why is the consumer wanting to buy this particular brand of yours? What is the underlying reason? And there's a lot of examples in consumer insight. And that's how Smirnoff came about. That's how Irish Bailey came about. What they did was that they did a lot of research with people, with target customers and consumers. They identified what was going to be driving them. And that's how they came up with insight. And that is why they are the most successful liquor company in the world. If you go to any 5-star bar, 80% of the shelf space will be occupied by their brands because they have hit upon consumer insight most beautifully than anyone else. Consumer insight is basically identifying what your need will be. What is your actual need? And bring out a solution for that. Where to look? Newspapers, websites, blogs, wikis, podcasts, videos, news sites, newsletter magazines, books, book reviews, presentations, reports, etc., etc., etc. And what are you looking for? Identify opinion leaders, the voice in the wilderness on the fringe, whether they're experts or professional or pundits or amateur or fringe. Why are we talking so much about this? Because it is those people in the fringe who have thought it very, very differently than what you and I would have probably thought of. One of the problems or one of the issues with education is that it teaches us to look at things in a very disciplined manner. It doesn't really teach us to look outside the box very easily. And this is the problem with education globally. And this is why people like Bill Gates, they said, look, it's too cramping. I need to get out. I need to start looking at things differently. And it is those people who started looking at things differently, who challenged the status quo, who said that, look, I'm not going to be tied down by this, are the ones who've gone on to create empires and gone on to create things which are very, very different. Jeff Bezos is one of them, with Amazon, with e-commerce. Looking for new, the first, the ideas, the change, the surprise, the opportunity, the threats. Competitive advantage comes from the periphery, from emerging issues, not from trends. Your real competitive advantage is going to come from the periphery, not from trends. Trends are going to be taking their own time. Are we done yet? The rise of pervasive computing and increasing connectedness. In another 10 years, how many of you would agree with me that if I say, in another 10 years, the number of bank branches are going to reduce by at least 50%? All of you disagree? Why? Why do you say so? Online banking, phone banking, mobile, whatever. You have another set of jobs that are going to go haywire. The tellers and the cashiers. Gone are the days, that you would not have seen it, but your professors would have seen it. The days when only public sector banks were there. When you would go in the morning at 10 o'clock, wanted to withdraw money. That particular teller or the cashier, whatever you want to call him, did not come. So you would wait patiently because you had no other option. At the most, after half an hour, 45 minutes, you would complain to the bank manager. He's also helpless. He'll say, you know, I'm sorry, you know, have a cup of tea or something of that sort. And he'll just come. Finally, whenever he saunters in, whether it's 11 or 11:30, and once he gets settled in, you have a chance to withdraw your money. Today, no one's going to wait for that. No one. Those days are over. Forget about ATM. Even ATM is going to get passe. The potential impact of the metaverse, where virtual and physical come together. What does the World Future Society say? Quantum computers will arrive by 2021, where things are rapidly going to be changing. That's another 5 years from today. Biometric security by 2010, already here. Many organizations today, they don't rely on the swipe card anymore. It's either the finger impression or even the iris impression. Biometrics for workmen and staff is today going to be the in thing. Challenge of protecting privacy increasing. Virtual immortality is within reach. Power to make things invisible may be at hand. Artificial intelligence surpassing human intelligence. That's a big worry. Virtual education, mainstream by 2015, already here. How many of you heard of MOOCs, MOOCs as you want to call it? Yeah, heard of it? That's increasingly coming into this. Massive open online courses. There are Coursera.com, etc. Increasingly, organizations are going to them in a big way. Human knowledge capability will continue to double every year. Technology will lead to educated illiterates. But only 30% of the world's population will have access to IT services by 2016. That's again a worry. And if you look at India, this percentage is even less. Managing the future, being on top of innovation and change. What is innovation? Turning the outcomes of the creative process into useful products, services, or work methods, where inputs, transformation leads to transformation, which leads to output. What is change? Organizational change. Any alterations in the people, structure, or technology of an organization is deemed as an organizational change. Handling emerging challenges, how the best organizations handle it. Companies are reconciling themselves to long-term downturn in already established markets. This is very important. Previously, if you had a bad year, 1 year, or 1.5 years, then for the next 5-6 years were good years. Today it can be every alternate year. 2013, the entire automobile industry almost sank. Like, if all the capacities, if you added all the capacities of the automobile industry, say it was 1 million vehicles, which they could manufacture in a year, the industry's sale was only 250,000. It came to 25% of the installed capacity. And that called for a lot of change in the industry. Many industries went to 2-day and 3-day work week. The unions knew that there was no other option. They played ball. They also supported. So workmen were paid for only 2 or 3 days that they came to work, because you didn't have demand. And if you didn't have demand, there's no point keeping the factory open and producing things and paying salary for 7 days a week. Increased exposure to a volatile world economy and markets. So long as you were insulated, you were looking only at the Indian market, you were fine. Because the demand was far outstripping the supply. But the moment the borders were opened way back in 1991, and today, anyone can enter into the country, either through a manufacturing setup or even someone can import. For example, if you look at tires, cheap Chinese imports are coming to the country to the extent of 1.5 lakh tires a month. So that's 30% of the capacity for radial tires. And that's the most profitable lot. Several emerging and interconnected challenges, deep recession, Eurozone, Brexit, other issues, threats of cyber conflict, full-blown conflict in the Middle East, etc. Middle East is like a cauldron. It's a pot which is boiling, about to explode. And it can happen any day. In a globalized and interconnected world, companies cannot insulate themselves from such risks. So how do you prepare for uncertainty? Recovery of existing mature markets is unpredictable. No one knows how long this downturn will last. Volatility in national economies, currencies, global commodity pricing, and other things is now a fact of business life. To succeed, companies must plan around these things. So the sort of planning that you were used to, looking at annual brand plan, etc., is one thing. What's more important is that you've got to look at the vagaries that can come in. You may have planned something, but what about if something goes wrong? You've also got to plan for failures. Companies thriving in such a volatile environment share several specific characteristics. More outward looking and focused on the market, go where the market is, respond smartly and quickly to change. And when you say respond smartly and quickly to change, it can also result in responding quickly enough to reduce the workforce when there's a downturn, and increase the workforce when there's an upturn. Ensuring that you have skills which are already always contemporary. They understand what drives cost and value, engage closely with stakeholders and unleash their talent. The world will continue to go globalize and face velocity and volatility. What matters is how organizations respond to this change. Improving efficiency will become key to surviving intensifying competition. And what will flexible companies do? Use technology to improve productivity. Restructure work practices to be more flexible. Re-engineer supply chains to increase revenues as well as crunching costs. Innovate to reach new customers, unlocking niches in mature markets and market share in emerging ones. In all, they will find a way to adapt and flourish in today's market. Supply chains must create sustainable cost savings to support margins and help pay for growth elsewhere. Innovation in this area is crucial for businesses' sustainability in a globalized environment. Supply chain today is probably getting a lot more attention than what it did five years ago, because the sort of savings that can come from supply chain today is a recognized fact. Obvious cost-cutting measures have already been taken. Firms face the need for deeper cuts without damaging company performance or even morale. Payoff for making the right decisions is worth it. A 1% reduction in costs achieved through a sophisticated procurement strategy is equivalent to a 10% increase in sales. Create new relationships with partners that foster innovation. Now, I'll take a second here. It won't be a surprise if you see two automobile companies which are competing with each other actually sharing the same production floor. Who manufactures Sony televisions? Well, for a long time it was Samsung which was manufacturing Sony televisions, except the very high-end ones, the Bravia variety. But most of it was being manufactured by Samsung. You will have increasing competitors coming together because that will pare down their costs. And they'll be competing at a very different level. Identify, evaluate major industry trends and leverage insights from successful competitors and market entrants. Identify sourcing locations and develop the right supply chain model to meet their needs best. And when you talk about, you know, learning from others, one of our biggest learnings in MRF has been from one of our contractors. You may think a contractor is much smaller. And yes, in turnover terms, he's much, much smaller. But the sort of processes that they have come up with, we found that we were nowhere near them. Our learning can come from anyone. Only thing, we've got to be actually very, very clear that we're open to embrace this learning which is coming, which is staring at us. Assess customer-facing functions. Identify areas for measurable improvement in value, effectiveness, efficiency, and quality of services delivered. Evaluate existing IT costs and systems for opportunities to improve efficiency. The Great Depression showed that technological change is particularly rapid during and just after major economic crisis. Most of you were not there in the Great Depression, neither was I, 1930s. But with each downsize, down cycle, there has been a lot more of innovation because the cost of innovation has really come down. Petrol prices were really about almost touching the $200 barrel or threatening to touch the $200 barrel. What do you think changed? What was the substitute for fuel, fossils like petrol, which the US found out? Shale gas. Now even shale gas has a threshold. Below $40, it becomes unprofitable. Everything has a cost. When the costs go up, you will always look for alternatives. And that is the match to play about. It's a very, very delicate balance. The more it goes up higher, you will always find someone coming up with an alternate which can help you pare your costs. Innovation is not always a managed process with the flow of new products and services commanded from the top. It tends to be messy, unpredictable, and spontaneous. One size fits all is rarely a productive approach. Leveraging innovation, organization culture, and the ability to do things bottom-up and top-down lead to success. Innovative organizations drive culture and policies to promote and reward innovation systematically. External contributions such as commercial and academic partnerships can help too. What do you mean by academic partnerships? Exactly. Each industry today is having a technological collaboration with a leading institute. Even we are having it with some of the IITs and others, and even with the universities abroad, on working on those areas which is in the at the frontier end. Because any organization will not have the resources to do hardcore research. And that is where the partnership really matters. In the West, this is a way of life. In India, this is catching up very, very fast. Innovation often occurs through networking and critical mass. Companies exist close to one another and compete, collaborate, and learn together. Innovative companies, of course, adapt quickly to emerging technologies. Crucial emerging technologies include cloud computing. I don't want to go into that because you must have heard enough and more about it. New technologies help with better cost control, branding promotion, and strategic management. Companies now use big data to find new business insights. So much so that we have developed something in-house, our HR team, to look at who could be the people who could actually be leaving your company, possible attrition. And it's not difficult. It's just a question of putting your mind to it. New technologies help, okay. Emerging technologies are increasingly seen as opportunities rather than threats. It has globalized environment has increased competition for staff. So therefore, those of you who have contemporary skills are going to be at a premium. Experience of your people will not necessarily grow as quickly as the market. It will not, because the market is going to change far more significantly. Finding qualified workers with IT skills, problem-solving abilities, and deductive reasoning is going to be a challenge. Leverage diversity to improve the pool of labor. Undertake workforce planning driven by long-term strategic talent needs. This leverage diversity to improve the pool of labor is something that we have found very, very necessary. Many of our retired people have had a lot of skills which we find a lot of the youngsters don't have. We are perforce going back to them for short-term assignments. So that's the only way we know that we can leverage their skills and knowledge to ensure the rest of the population start increasing their knowledge and skills. Undertake workforce planning driven by long-term strategic talent needs. Optimize workforce management by analyzing labor costs, scheduling, productivity and turnover, and recommending actions to improve worker flexibility. And how do you deal with people challenges? Being from HR, I have to devote one slide to this. Demonstrate that you value people, because people have a choice. They need not stick with you. There's enough other people who can give them an opportunity. Share leadership vision, goals, and direction. It's got to be a two-way communication, and they want to know where the organization is headed. They want to know what is the vision of the company. Trust people. Provide information for decision-making. Delegate authority and impact opportunities, not just more work. Provide frequent feedback and be willing to accept feedback from them also. Listen to learn and ask questions for guidance. Help employees feel rewarded for empowered behavior. This is the last slide, so you can take a sigh. Challenges, at the end, let me tell you, challenges cannot be predicted. No matter what you do, no matter what you plan, no matter whom you get, no one way of solving a problem. The way you solved the problem last year is not probably going to be helping you this year. Uneven patterns of change and unpredictability. Achieving growth by leveraging talent, leveraging innovation, and of course, adaptability of enterprise, which will of course include people. Thank you.
The hall is now open for questions.
Good afternoon. I'm Shruti from PMHR BIMM. Sir, as an HR point of view, what is more important, the employee satisfaction or completing the organization goals? Because I'm sure it's not always easy to find a balance between the two.
You asked me a very difficult question, to be honest. Whether employee satisfaction or organization goals. See, if you don't put the organization first, if the organization goal is not met, you really cannot have employee satisfaction. And you've got to trust the leaders of the organization that they have a vision for the organization, they have goals for the organization. And unless you meet those goals, and if it's going to be at the absence of meeting the organization goals and only employee satisfaction, yes, employees will be very satisfied if you don't give them too much of work, if you don't put too much of work pressure, if you give them a good salary, if you give them good outings, etc. I don't know if that is really employee satisfaction. In my tenure so far, I found employees are satisfied when they have a lot of meaning in their work, when they have a lot of challenges, when they start learning more, not necessarily more salary. The people who are paid more are not necessarily the ones who are most satisfied. The ones who are most satisfied are normally the ones who have more work to do, who actually love doing what they want to do. So actually the two go in hand, if you cannot really separate the two.
Sir, I wanted to ask a question related to DIG yourself, since you are a part of that company. So
you're a very spiritual person, aren't you?
No, sir. My question to you is that when in 2014 May, when Diageo purchased United Spirits Limited, it took a decision to sell White Mackey and Royal Challengers Bangalore team. That they quoted that we want to sell the non-core assets of US. So can you throw some light on that?
Okay, then I've got to take you back to 2001. 2001, when Diageo was in the country, they had two sets of brands, domestic brands and the global brands. Global brands were all Smirnoff and Johnny Walker, etc., etc. Domestic brands were brands like Green Label, which had already touched 2 million cases by then. Diageo follows a concept called economic profit. Now, don't ask me to explain that now. That takes a lot of time. Read it up. And they were very clear that unless a brand is economically profitable, if it's not EP positive, don't go after the brands. Because they were so profitable everywhere in the globe, they said, rather put money on those brands, which is EP positive. You can always come back and buy the brands later on. That's their award philosophy. So in 2001, we put up this presentation to the global CEO. MD and myself had gone because of the restructuring plan. And we said, we'll divide the company into two divisions, global brands and domestic brands. And we look at the EP positive after 1 year. If the domestic brands were not EP positive, we will hive off the brands. So the domestic brands were hived off. And the MD who was then the MD then, he bought it. And after a few months, sold it to Vijay Mallya, who owned United Spirits. Now, if you look at the sales in number of cases, it's largest in India, but not necessarily in value terms. Your bagpiper sells far more than Johnny Walker. But one peg of Johnny Walker Black Label would be equivalent to one bottle of bagpiper. So when the market got saturated, because Ivan Menezes was then the regional director for India at that point in time. So he was one of those who also supported this, saying that let's hive off the brands. Today is a global head, but then the market has got saturated globally. India is the promised market. Huge consumption and upwardly mobile consumption. So it made a lot of business sense for them to acquire the brands, to acquire the largest competitor for them. It happened to United Spirits because they had a lot of domestic brands which were selling a lot. White and Mackey and others are very, very insignificant brands. It doesn't sell much, not too much of volume or profits coming in there. It makes more sense to take the United Spirits brands. Because in sheer volume terms, there's far more. Profitability is still low. But by doing that, you're actually going to slowly start upgrading it. And don't forget, you have a large population in India, which is upwardly mobile. And that's going to bring you new profits. So this entire decision was born out of that. And that any business will do. Don't forget, Diageo bought over Seagram's also.
Good afternoon, sir. On your right, yeah. My name is Pooja Rawal. I'm from BIMM. I wanted to ask you, as you talked about conventional and managing diversity, problem-solving approach, and also all such things include emotional intelligence. So after the advent of artificial intelligence, what do you think would be the scope left for emotional intelligence?
Very good question. Let me tell you, emotional intelligence will always play a major role. Because end of the day, okay, artificial intelligence has its place, but it's not going to replace all the human beings who are going to be in play. And if you look at people who are successful, are those whose EQ quotient is far higher than their IQ levels. Because what's more important is that I may be very intelligent and have all the brain power in the world, but if I don't know how to relate to you and get work out of you and influence you, I will not be successful. And you'll find this increasingly happening. Those in colleges, the gold medalists in colleges, both in engineering and in MBA institutes, very few of them go on to succeed in industry. When I say succeed, means go on to reach the highest level. It is more the people who had a better EQ who've gone on to succeed and get larger and larger roles. The IQ levels of those people may still be high, but that's not what the role of a CEO and leadership front is all about.
Sir, a recent article in Human Capital stated that there's a new upcoming function practice in HR. It's reverse integration. where the CEOs and the managers are teamed up with the millennials to work together. So both of them can learn from each other. So, sir, how it is practically implemented in the organization? Because the higher the hierarchy, the higher is the ego.
Higher is the ego?
Yeah.
Okay. See, this is increasingly happening not just last few years. It's been happening for quite some time. The reason being, there's a lot of segmentation. The millennials and others who have come in, their aspirations and what makes them tick is very different from people of my generation who started working in the 80s. Unless you listen to them, and this goes back to listening in the organization, unless you're willing to listen to various segments, you're not going to understand what makes each one of them tick. And that's increasingly important. And so much so, let me also share something more with you, since you've raised that pertinent question. Many companies have gone in for shadow boards. There's a board of directors. What's a shadow board? You have youngsters, bright youngsters, who are emerging leaders, who've got potential, whom you identify as having potential. You form a shadow board with them. And you have one mentor from the board who mentors them. And they are given life problems which the board or the company is facing. And you ask them to work on it. Oftentimes, the sort of solutions that they come forward with is mind-blowing. So this is actually not just a recent phenomenon. This is happening for the last 10 to 12 years in many companies, especially in MNCs. So hopefully you'll be one of the shadow boards in somewhere.
Good afternoon, sir. Good, I'm Akshay Joshi from BIMM Marketing Executive Batch. And recently, what we saw yesterday, the Flipkart, they have fired 500 to 700 people. So, you know, with the VUCA thing being the buzzword, and, you know, do you think that there is a need of a regulatory body for HR also? Or, you know, since it's core business, so what's happening makes a lot of sense from the business point. Because at the end of the day, people have lost their jobs. And we could also be at the receiving end at some point of time in later future. So do you think that there is a need of a HR regulatory body?
What do you mean by HR regulatory body?
something on the lines of just like we have consumer forum, wherein people, you know, if something wrong has been done, they could go there for the redressal, something a grievance redressal from an HR point of view.
Okay. Firstly, if I'm not making profits, you cannot force me to run the business. Let's be very clear. So if I have to downsize, I will jolly well downsize. Okay. Now, taking this particular question about Flipkart. See, Flipkart is in a nascent stage. They are competing against a monster called Amazon, who've done this game and gone through their experience, their learning curve. Flipkart is just going through their learning curve. If you look at this industry, e-commerce industry, what are the main costs of an e-commerce industry? They don't have any manufacturing. They have a large warehouse. That's one cost. And if you own that land, it's practically free for you, practically but not free. The other cost is the manpower cost. Now, if you're going to find it difficult to run the business, these things are going to get cut short. Now, why is it getting cut? And that comes to automation and IT and technology. Many of the jobs, the lower jobs, are repetitive in nature. You'll find drones and other things replacing them. I've got some friends in Flipkart. So I had a chat with them. They think it's the lower-end jobs which are very repetitive and manual in nature, which is getting filled in by automation or even drones or whatever. That's bound to happen anywhere. By having a regulatory body, what can the regulatory body say? No. Even if you're running at a loss, you please employ these people.
No, sir, what I'm trying to say is, a year back, the biggest and the fattest salary packages were given by Flipkart. And it becomes really, you know, astounding to see that one point of time, you're ready to give away that kind of money. And, you know, just like 9 months down the line, you are downsizing. I mean, that could be cruel business, but it's just astounding fact. So.
That's harsh reality. Welcome to the real world. Welcome to the real world. That is harsh reality. It happens. Oftentimes, when we hear these fat packages being offered, is how I wish, you know, I was getting that package. You wish that?
Yes, sir.
Sure. Everyone wishes that. Now, there is always going to be a trade-off. When the costs are high, the risks are also extremely high. When the costs are much lower, the risks are also much lower. High costs will always have high risks. You are saying that in the Middle East today, the banking sector is in doldrums, real doldrums. A lot of my friends there in the treasury and other areas, they're all looking for jobs. Why? Even in India, HSBC is laying off a lot of people. Standard Chartered Bank is in a total mess. Royal Bank of Scotland, big mess. Name one foreign bank which is not in a mess. That's, see, these are things that will happen along with downturns. You have to be adaptable to face it. You have to have skill sets which are going to be in demand. If you do not have skill sets which are going to be in demand, then you will be one of those who's going to get laid off. If you always aim for the highest salary, et cetera, you may get it. But be prepared to always remain contemporary. Because if you aren't, the possibility of you being waylaid is very high at the next downturn.
Thank you, sir.
Sir? My name is Anadi Divedi. I am from BITM. Sir, as you know that Birla Tyres, Birla company is also in tyre manufacturing. They just export tyres to many countries, but why they are don't in the Indian market and why they don't use it? Sir, my next question is that as Chinese tyres are being nowadays so cheaper, so how can you tackle that?
Let me come to Birla Tyres first. How many of you know that Birla Tyres were sold off to JK Tyres? They had approached us also. Birla Tyres is in a total mess. They got a factory in Pantnagar, which every monsoon gets waterlogged. They got some almost 19 unions there. See, today, you know, you can start any business, but unless you're clear about your practices, you can be in a total mess. That's one. And I'm not too sure Birla Tyres is really exporting anything. Because if you look at the chart, they're way, way, way behind. Way, way behind. With regard to Chinese imports, today, they are selling tyres at the cost of their raw material because they just want revenue in. So yes, it's a fight. We are fighting. We are fighting from all fronts. But I can't tell you what all we are doing on that front, obviously. But we are still holding firm. We are still the number one in the country. Despite that.
Sir. Good afternoon, sir. Sir.
Sorry. Yes, definitely yes. And those of you who have not heard his question, what he's saying is that whether India's infrastructure is lagging behind the fast-changing technology, yes, it is. But there are rapid changes also being made. See, despite everything, I don't know if you've had the chance to read the newspapers this morning. It had pictures of boats in Bangalore because it got waterlogged, because the infrastructure support is poor. But despite that, Bangalore is an IT hub. The same thing has happened to Gurgaon yesterday and day before. Okay? The same thing has happened. See, there are challenges, no doubt about it. But the resilience of the Indian workers is very high. We managed to keep on fighting because there is that thing that, yes, we will come, we shall surmount and overcome this. So while there are challenges, definitely yes, and while we need to go, if you look at this amount of roads that are being constructed and good roads, there is a rapid, what do you call it, a road expansion actually happening. It's taking time. If you look at Bombay Airport today, the new airport, T2, I think it's as good as any in the world. If you look at T3 in Delhi, as good as any in the world. So you'll have some of the best things happening, some of the not so best things also happening. So we will get there. It's not that we are there already.
Thank you, sir. Your views on a wide range of contemporary issues, be it changing technology, competition challenges, ethical dilemma, people challenges, or sustenance as a key to success, have sown seeds of divergent thinking among us student managers, which we would certainly as we march ahead towards a brighter future.
I now request Brigadier M.L. Bambani, advisor, Sri Balaji Society, to present a memento to our guest, Mr. Roy Joseph.